Thank you for that, Neil. At least we're ending on a positive note this morning. We've had a lot of positive comments throughout this programme, which has been largely devoted to Darren Clark and our winners here in Northern Ireland. Gerry, good morning to you.
Good morning, Linda. How are you? Is that fat thing still away?
Yes. If you're referring to Stephen, the answer is yes.
How long is he away for?
Well, is he away?
How long is he going to be away for?
Oh, I'm here this week and I think Joel's here next week.
Yeah, but he's away another 2 weeks.
Oh, yes, peace for 2 weeks.
For God's sake, these BBC cuts aren't working at all. Anyway, okay, well done, kiddo.
Carry on.
We're going to have a day of special mashups today, unless I'm forced to stop.
What was that about?
What was what about?
Oh, I don't know.
Just friendly banter. Called you so many times today, and I guess it's all true what your girlfriend said. But you don't ever want to see me again, and your brother's going to kill me, and he's 6'10". I guess you call it cowardice, but I'm not prepared to go on like this. There's a bit of a mashup. It's called I Can't Stand the Sultans of Swing. That's from The Police and from Dire Straits. I don't know, I didn't talk about this to you before the programme today because I don't ask you stuff. Yeah. What I've decided to do today was to play some carefully selected mashups, ones that I think are particularly good, some of my particular favourites. I know some of the people out there don't like it, but many, many people do, and I think it's important that I play what many of the people like. And I cannot bring myself to not play things that I know some of them won't like, because I get great pleasure sometimes in playing songs that certain of the people don't like. Do you understand what I'm saying?
No.
Good. The number to contact of this programme, if you want to ring. How are the phones working today? They weren't working on Friday.
Yes, yes, everything's fine.
There was a bit of a strike on Friday. Were we sabotaged on Friday?
I don't think so.
08459 5 the undertone in there. 08459 555 678. Is that our number? Was that the whole number that I just gave? 08459 555.
Sorry.
Why did you listen, see if I make a mistake?
I was talking to Emma.
You were not?
Emma was mouthing something over to me and I couldn't get what it was.
What was it?
I couldn't make out. I
can't get her to mouth something to me.
No.
Go on. I had no fun this weekend at all. Go on, get her to... Emma, go on, mouth something at me.
No,
go on.
No.
Look, ask her to lean over.
No.
Come on, Emma. Go on, mouth something at me. Any other thing. Go on.
No.
Go on. Woo! I enjoyed that. She mouthed, you didn't see what that was. She turned her back to you and mouthed something at me, and I know what she said. She said, my husband is asking for you. The number to ring is 08459 555 678. The email address is jerry.anderson@bbc.co.uk, and the text messaging service for those of you who have not had the benefit of a normal education is 81771. I have to say, golf, what can I say? We have to mention Darren Clark. Isn't that great?
Absolutely.
Absolutely fine. Now, one of the BBC people got in trouble about saying something about Darren Clark. They said maybe his winning will make us stop fighting. And there's a bit of trouble about that. Did you see that in the paper?
No.
You didn't see that?
No, neither did Emma.
No, that's because two of you have no legs.
I said. Who said? I said that.
No, you, not you. Some BBC commentator said, somebody said about Darren Clark winning. Said, oh, maybe it'll stop them, stop fighting. Maybe it'll make them stop fighting. Everybody got annoyed, you see. Do you not know nothing about that?
No.
You don't look at the papers. You don't listen. You're too busy manufacturing your swing. Anyway, but Peter Alice was very, very good. Did you hear what he said? He said something which I thought, and I agreed with 100%. He said, this is the best thing that's happened to golf. These three guys from Northern Ireland. And do you know what he said? Did you hear him saying this?
No.
He said that the three of them are very, very good because they are personalities and they enjoy themselves and they can talk and they're nice people. Yeah. The unspoken thing was a lot of the guys can talk and they're not terribly nice. What he was saying was that they're real people. The three of them are the same. Like Darren Clark, G-Mac, and Rory McIlroy, very nice people. They can sit and talk to you and they talk normal. They don't have that interview. You know what the footballers do? Not kind of the closed lip.
I haven't got one golf ball from any of them.
Now you say, well, I can't see why. I mean, you were in contact with Rory. I know on a number of occasions you refused to tell me a story about him, which was a private golf story, and you wouldn't tell me. And I thought that was very bad. You wouldn't share your little experiences with me after all. I mean, how long have we been together now?
Over 20.
Stop! Listen, look, there's another interview that you missed.
What?
Look at this here. Now, I got this morning and I thought that you would have set this up.
What's your levels like?
They seem to be all right to me. What are the people saying?
Sound a bit loud.
Not only because I'm brash.
Oh, that's so. Well, yeah.
It's only because I'm brash. Here's one. I mean, I expected this interview to be set up when I came in here this morning. You're not doing your job.
What is it?
It's Gabby Logan talking about sustainable living.
Oh,
I mean, how did you miss that?
I'm blaming Emma.
Emma, don't let him blame you. I mean, that should have leaped up at you this morning. Gabby Logan talking about sustainable living. She's available at 1 o'clock today.
Gee.
And all the people are getting her. All the sexually talking to her.
I apologise.
And everything. And what about your man didn't get fired out of The Apprentice, the man from Cookstown?
Who?
Jim Eastwood. Do you not know anything?
What did Eastwood see?
Barney's son.
See anything to Barney?
I have no idea. Well, everybody from Cookstown is called Eastwood, so I don't know. Anything to Clint, you say? I really don't know. He was fired from The Apprentice last night.
Who said?
Hello?
Yes?
He was fired from The Apprentice last night.
I don't think it's very funny.
It's supposed to be funny.
Eh?
It's not supposed to be funny. Well, me, Elma Titter.
What?
It's not supposed to be funny. It's not supposed to be funny. It's serious about people making money. It's not supposed to. Did you think it was a comedy?
Yeah, I thought about it. Is it not like The Office?
No, it's not. It's very. It's funny in a weird way.
Yeah.
It's people pretending to be stern. And Alan Sugar's like a big pantomime villain. He doesn't believe a word he says. And
is that not scripted?
No, it's not. But it kind of is in a way. Did you think it was a play?
I thought it was a series.
No, it is a series.
Yeah, but you understand? I thought it was a wee, like
it's very false.
Like compact.
That was in 1958. it's not a series, and it's not a comedy, and it's not compact. What it is, it's a bunch of people trying to impress the TV cameras so that they will be able to go to big do's and eat big feeds in Brussels, as someone once accused John Hume of doing.
So they're not actors?
They are. Well, they more or less are. They're all acting anyway.
That's what I thought.
The biggest ham of them all is Alan Sugar.
Yeah, that's right. But Alan Sugar, that's...
I'm firing you! You're no good! They're all like kind of Jeremy Clarkson type of things. But what would the poet... What would the Ulster poet say about that? Well, I'm glad you asked me. I'm sitting here looking up at Sol, looking at Slemish, where St. Patrick himself herded a few sheep. St. Patrick, of course, as you know, is the man who invented Catholics. And look at the trouble that caused. I'm looking up and I'm saying, that long lad Eastwood out of Apprentice, if I had been anything to do with it, I would have given them the money. See, apparently Alan Sugar gives a quarter of a million of his own money to the person who wins, and that person goes on and goes on to the business, and perhaps a little slice, or as they say in The Sopranos, I'll have a little taste of that. Is that a convincing mafia accent?
Not really.
I'll have a little taste of that. All I want is a taste. Remember they used to say, give me a taste, I want a taste, give me a taste. I gotta have a taste. I'd like a taste of that. A little soupçon. A little dribble of that down me lips. I think I'm losing my sight.
So, this by Eastwood?
Yes, he did not win. That's all I'm saying.
Right.
It's on the lips of everybody who has no lives. The people who watch television, people who watch The Apprentice have no lives. Yeah. All the people who watch The Apprentice thought in Northern Ireland that he would win, making it a bumper weekend for the people from Ulster. Darren Clark, G-Mac,
Rory McIlroy, Jim Eastwood. The sky's the limit. I'm proud of being from Ulster. Are you not, Sean?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
I know that's not a mashup. I played that by mistake. What do you say?
There's a wee call for you.
It's okay.
I know.
It's all right. We've all the time in the world. The golf, the success of Darren Clark, G-Mac, and Rory McIlroy are changing the habits of the nation. A lady writes to me who never mentioned golf to me before. Her name is Michelle. She's a regular. She's a daily communicant. I don't mean that she's a Catholic, but she communicates with this program on a daily basis. And she said, for the first time in my life, I sat glued to the TV on Saturday and Sunday watching, in inverted commas, the golf.
Yeah.
No, I did that myself.
I
do you remember I had confessed to you?
I watched right through the very, very.
And it's all right you doing it, but people like
me. Yeah, but normally I would turn off. I wouldn't watch the presentation. I wouldn't listen to the after game interviews or anything like that. I just turn it off. But I wanted to hear everything that Big Clarkie had to say last night.
He was very good at the presentation, wasn't he? He was very sincere. And you knew that this was the guy. But see, this is the best thing ever happened in Northern Ireland, because people around the world are seeing three. And, you know, those three people are a complete cross-section of people from Northern Ireland, you know. They're not one of them alike, really, when you actually think about it. And the three of them, they're three guys plucked at random.
The good, the bad, and the ugly.
Well, which one's the ugly?
Ah, you see.
No, they're plucked at random, basically, from the Northern Ireland population, because, I mean, there's no such thing as a dynasty of golfers. Mm. These are people, you know, it's just from all different backgrounds, three of them plucked, and the three of them are actually quite similar. They're very personable, they've good personalities, they're nice to people, and they're funny, and they enjoy life. That's what Peter Alice said, and I was very pleased to hear that. Because it's like us in a way. Well, like me anyway, not like you. My husband and our kids had no choice but to watch it too. And we're now considering having a go at playing it. You see, these are people who are going to go out and buy golf clubs.
Well,
I'm going out today to buy us all Rupert the Bear trousers and Argyle jumpers.
Now, Emma was asking me this morning. She asked me, what's a birdie? How does it work? How does the scoring work? She says, I was watching it, but I couldn't follow it. So I was explaining to Emma just this morning how it all works. So
funny you should say that. This lady says, I now know what all the fuss is about. I couldn't believe I'm saying this. Until 2 days ago, as the subject of golf came up, my eyes glazed over. Mm. It helps me to know what you're talking about too. My dictionary got fingered somewhat, looking up birds like handicap, birdie, eagle, par, bogey. Suffice to say, I was hard to listen to. I have a question for Sean. If an eagle is two strokes below par, why is a double eagle, also known as an albatross, Only 3 strokes.
Don't know.
Do you not?
No.
I have no idea. You should know that, should you not?
I don't understand the question.
If an eagle is 2 strokes below par, okay?
Right.
Is that, do you accept that?
Birdie, an eagle, yeah.
An eagle is 2 strokes below par.
An albatross.
It's also known as an albatross.
Yeah.
An eagle is also known as an albatross.
No. No, I think an albatross is at a par 5 only.
Okay.
I think.
Okay, well, leave the albatross out of it because it's circling overhead. Yeah. If an eagle is 2 strokes below par, why is a double eagle only 3 strokes below par? That's what she wants to know. Do you accept that that is the fact?
No.
Is that not true?
I don't do golf talk.
But you play golf.
Ah, but the boy beside you tells you.
I mean, you don't know?
No. I don't understand that question.
A double eagle. What is it? Do you know what a double eagle is?
I've never heard of a double eagle.
Do you know what an eagle is?
Yes.
It's 2 strokes below par.
Right.
So a double eagle should be 4 strokes below par. But in actual fact, it's 3. That's all I'm saying. I'm not trying to pick a fight here.
I know, but I just don't know where we're going with this.
Well, I'm just reading you what I see here. And you don't seem to understand.
No, I
can nearly understand it myself.
Well, then you answer it.
Because I don't know the answer.
Well, I talked to Columba.
Columba broke a wonder and he blamed it on St. Paul. I used to sing that in church. Surely it should be 4 strokes. Double usually implies twice as many. Then again, maybe 4 strokes below par would be better to describe as
Get
a whole...
Stephen Watson on again.
No, Stephen. No, it was bad enough the last time. No. Do I at least sound like I know what I'm talking about? Just as a matter of fact, you do, Michelle. Anyway, congratulations, she says to Darren Clark. I loved his wee look around the crowd when he missed the last stroke of the 18th hole. That was a lovely moment, wasn't it?
I wonder what he said. No one quite caught what he said.
I think he says what I say to you every morning. And then when he putted it in, the shivers down my neck were nothing ordinary when the crowd stood up and roared. Great stuff. I'm converted. She's converted.
Good.
Well, I had a very busy weekend. Do you want to ask me about my weekend?
Okay.
I had a very busy weekend. I'd like to say hello and to all the nice people who came along to Downpatrick on Saturday night to see myself and Sean Donnelly. It was a very good night.
Anyone asking for me?
Not a single person. And on Friday night, Radio 4 people were asking for you and they say, has Sean recovered yet? I said, no, there's nothing wrong with him. At least they said, sound as if there is. No, we recorded the programme and that was really nice on Friday night. It's called With Great Pleasure and it'll be on, I think it's August the 15th. I'll let the people know about that. It's a very personal thing and I quite enjoyed
Did,
that.
Did Janet turn up?
Janet never came. I knew she wouldn't because any promise of support that I get from the people who work on this programme is usually hollow. None of you came. I was on my own. Not even Emma. Nobody. Emma wouldn't even mouth anything from me from the crowd. It's just one of those things. Anyway, I'm used to that. I'm used to having to do it alone. Great show last week, kid. Great shows which kept many directors of News Corp International from leaping out of the windows of skyscrapers. Sources close to New Corp said old Rupert Murdoch was slowly making his way towards an open window and he was trying to defenestrate himself when he heard Mr. Coyle say, if I had to live my life over again, I'd be a barnacle scraper in a marina. This stopped him in his tracks. And he said, now, there's a man with more than his share of sorrows. If that man, above all other men, can still dream, then by Ayers Rock, Ayers Rock, of course, known to the Aborigines as I will stand my ground and see this thing through. Rupert staggered back to his throne and yelled, bring me the ginger minx. That is Rebecca Brooks. She was dragged in, thrown at the master's feet. Rebecca, said the press baron, you've been like a daughter to me, but I must now throw you to the wolves. I must protect my son. I will never give up my little James. Do you hear me? Never, 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 paraphrasing Ian Paisley when he was at his best. Tommy, my cat, paced up and down and said, I wonder, did the News of the World hack into my phone? Who would want to listen to your mewlings? I scoffed. Tommy coughed and said, over the years, I have had secret and protracted conversations with Stephen Nolan. I looked him up and down. Were you in some kind of relationship with the Oval One? Platonic, said Tommy, purely platonic. We'd go out to dinner, maybe see a show, and then go back to Stephen's house for crisps, chocolate and cake and coke and hamburgers and cheese and pizzas and roast beef and chicken and turkey and quail. Tubby would then put on a little Barry White and we'd just sit there telling lies about Jerry Anderson. You're playing a dangerous game, Tommy. Tommy bit his nails and said, do you think our innocent, purely platonic friendship could be misconstrued? Of course it could. You must come clean, call a press conference, which is why you saw Tommy on TV making rambling, veiled references to that man, Stephen Nolan. I'm not well, you know.
Yo-ho, there's a call pending. Waiting for quite a while.
Do you hear me not listening to you?
Yeah, but the call's been waiting. It's Columba. He's waiting for you. By now you should have somehow realized what you gotta do. I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now.
That's another mashup. That's called Carpenter's Wonderwall, of course. Wonderwall, Oasis, and the Carpenters. We've only just begun. Look, women are offering themselves to me. Mm-hmm. It says here,
what
dear
about Columba?
I've got to go to Columba in a minute. I apologise for this. I wish you would consider getting a female sidekick, like Radio 1 and BBC 2 have on their shows. A female presence would add a great deal to your show. Sean Coyle often interrupts you and spoils your stories.
Oh.
You'd be telling a joke or a story which I haven't heard, and he stops you. Just because he has heard it, he shouldn't interrupt you. You know, I'm always saying that to you. Half the time, he sounds depressed and preoccupied with himself. He's got you in one. This occurs so often, I'm desperate for a change. He seems to enjoy only sports references, which I dislike. You, on the other hand, always seem to care about the listener's interests and needs. For all your Radio Ulster needs, it's Radio Ulster.
He's really got you wrong, anyway, hasn't he?
She has.
Women
understand me. See, men like you don't like me. Men don't like me. Women know that underneath this...
I'm not a man, by the way.
What are you?
I'm just a person.
You're a man.
Not.
If somebody said, are you a man or a woman, what would you say?
I would say...
Neither?
No, I'm not a man. There's men. People grow...
A man is a man. No. A man is a male.
You have grown into a wee man.
A wee compact man.
You're a wee man.
My mother used to always say...
Do you remember that?
My mother would say, if we were walking along the street when I was a kid, she'd say, look at that man over there. I said, what man is that? That wee compact man.
Well, are you?
Are there any compact men anymore?
Tell me, are you a wee low set man?
Are we well set up man?
No, a wee low set.
There was wee low set men, yes, and there was wee well set up men, and then there was wee compact men. Remember we compact men that looked as if everything was all squeezed into one?
Yes, that was we barley men. Wasn't it? Yeah. But you're
we men, it looked as if they should be taller and the body was squeezed into a small body. Mm. And they always had suits that were too tight, we compact men. And they always had kind of broad shoulders and bellies, remember? Yeah. As if they were all bursting out. What happened to those? They're all wearing tracksuits now. You can't see their light of a man now. All you can see, I seen a great man the other day with his belly hanging over his trousers. Do you know the way sometimes men... Remember a long time ago, men used to have trousers. And because he had a big, big belly, they had to really tie the belt on really tight to keep the trousers up.
Disgusting looking.
And actually, it's just like unbelievable. I mean, if they have the belt on normally, the trousers fall down because the belly forces the trousers down. Yeah. So what you have to do is just, it's like a tourniquet. And the big belly's going...
What about Columba?
Do you know what I like too? Do you know, especially on the beach in the continent, I love spotting the silverbacks.
Well, I have to ask, what's the silverback? The white person.
But do you know the way David Attenborough is out and he says, "I'm standing here beneath the foliage in Uganda. This is the habitat of the mountain gorilla. There's a young gorilla just in front of me, and to the left-hand side, eating a piece of fruit, is a silverback." Silverback's the oldest male in the herd.
What about Columba?
They call him silver. What, you're obsessed with Columba.
The reason they call him
silverback because they go grey at the back.
Emma said he's waiting 15 minutes.
What's he what? Hello, Columba.
Hello?
I'm terribly sorry for keeping you waiting.
Oh, no, that's all right, Jerry. When you're a VIP, you're used to being ignored.
Obviously, this is a vital communication, or else Mr. Coyle would not have insisted on interrupting everything I said to make sure that you get on.
Normally, whenever I'm talking to people, people are talking to others, they realise that you're blind, when they don't talk to you. I normally say to them, it's great to be invisible as well as blind.
You're blind, are you?
Yes.
Well, it's far better to be talking on the radio when you're blind than not to be blind and not talking on the radio, isn't it? Well, how are you today?
No, I was ringing the other day and I was asked a question about a track of the best of Mark Knopfler called on the Toby. I was asking what the Toby was.
Oh, I knew the answer to that. It's not Toby. It's, I had the answer to that and I forgot to read it out. Did I read that out, Sean? Did I read out the answer to that?
Yes, and you told us.
What was it? Do you remember?
I don't remember.
Now you see. Am I not right at time?
You read it.
I read it out. It's not the Toby. It's another word that actually he didn't fully pronounce. It's a three syllable word. It's like Tobley or Toblerone.
No, you didn't give that explanation.
Did I not?
No. That's
well, I'll tell you what I'll do. It's in an email somewhere, and I'll...
And there's another one on it. He sings about a crocodile spelt with a K.
Yes.
Crocodile. What's he on about there, do you know?
I really don't know. Is that from the same album?
The best of Mark Knopfler and...
The best of Mark Knopfler. I thought maybe perhaps...
Dire Straits. No, one of the callers on it as well, singing a duet with him at the end.
Who's that now? Do you remember?
Is it Emmylou Harris?
Emmylou Harris. Well, obviously, the one I had was the duet album that she had with him. I think it was called... I can't remember what it was called. But obviously, they've taken a track off that and put it on the best of. I went to see Mark Knopfler one time in Ronnie Scott's club with a band called the Hillbillies. He's got this band called the Hillbillies. They play kind of country. And every once in a while, he does small gigs. And there was only like 100 people at it. It was about 5-6 years ago. And it was very hard to get in. And he was brilliant. He just sat there in a stool and he played the guitar and the band were playing behind him. They're all old fellas,
What do they call it here as well? A CD of rock guitar. It's all music.
That's right.
Played by him. It's really good.
Listen, I'll try and find out what the answer to that little query is. And if you keep listening, you like music then, obviously.
Oh, yeah. I go to quite a lot of concerts.
Good man. Listen, we're going to have to go now because it's coming up to 11 o'clock. Give us a wee ring again sometime when we have more time.
Okay.
All right, then. Okay. See you later. Bye.
You told him to give you a ring when you have some more time.
On 92 to 95 FM and 1341 medium wave, This is BBC Radio Ulster.
BBC News at 11 o'clock. I'm Anne-Marie Foster. Darren Clark's success at the Open yesterday has led to renewed calls for the championship to be held here. Tributes have been pouring in for the County Tyrone golfer after his emotional victory at Royal St George's. The Secretary of State, Owen Paterson, says it would be great to see the Open come to Northern Ireland. Hotel industry expert Michael Williamson says after three international victories in 13 months, the tourism industry should benefit.
It would not be unreasonable on the back of that to expect that we will see an influx of golfers coming to Northern Ireland. We have some absolutely fantastic courses amongst the very best in the world. So we have everything to offer and now we have the profile. So let's build on it.
The victims campaigner Alan McBride has been appointed as one of eight new members of the Human Rights Commission. Mr McBride lost his wife and father-in-law in the 1993 IRA bombing of a fish shop on Belfast's Shankill Road. The current Chief Human Rights Commissioner, Monica McWilliams, will be replaced by Professor Michael O'Flaherty, who's currently co-director of Nottingham University's Human Rights Law Centre. The new commission will take up their posts in September. The Education Minister, John O'Dowd, has approved the closure of two schools in County Antrim due to a decline in numbers. Lourdes Primary School in Whitehead and Braid Primary School near Carnlough will not reopen in September. The Mayor of London, Boris Johnson, has suggested that Scotland Yard's Assistant Commissioner, John Yates, is to be investigated by the Metropolitan Police Authority about his links to the former News of the World executive, Neil Wallace. Sir Paul Stevenson, the Met Commissioner, resigned yesterday after it emerged that Scotland Yard had employed Mr Wallace as a media consultant. Sport now, here's Denise Watson.
Darren Clark will receive a hero's welcome at Royal Portrush tomorrow at 12 noon. And he's up to 30th place from 111th place in the latest World Golf Rankings after his Open victory. It's a third major championship for a Northern Ireland golfer in 13 months. Donegal have beaten Derry by 111 to 8 points to become Ulster Senior Football Champions. Captain Michael Murphy scored the only goal of the game from the penalty spot. Cavan Miners beat Armagh by 12 points to 16 to win the Ulster title for the first time in 37 years. And Manchester City manager Roberto Mancini has said that an agreement has been reached for the sale of Argentinian striker Carlos Tevez to Corinthians. A £39 million bid from the Brazilian club was rejected last week, with City believed to be holding out for £50 million.
Finally, the weather forecast with Jackie McCann.
Persistent rain towards the north brings the potential for localised flooding during the first half of the day. It's a damp story wherever you are, with outbreaks of rain threatening on and off, although most of the rain won't be that heavy. During the afternoon, parts of Antrim and Down can expect drier and brighter conditions, but it stays breezy and cool, with temperatures reaching 16 Celsius at best.
BBC News.
BBC Radio Ulster. Travel News.
In Hollywood, Carlston Avenue remains closed between Torgrange and Winnie Hill from 8am until 8pm each day until Sunday. A diversion is in place via Lochinver Avenue, Rannoch Road and Dalwhinnie Road. Under the ferries and because of the weather, the 11:15 sailing from Ballycastle to Rathlin Island has been cancelled. And at the City of Derry Airport, tonight's 10:30 flight from London Gatwick has also been cancelled. Eileen Moyna reporting.
Travel News on BBC Radio Ulster.
On Talk Back with Wendy Austin today. It's going to start getting boring soon. First G-Mac, then Wee-Mac, and now Big Darren. We've got his dad, his local, the man who's driving his car home, and Northern Ireland's other sporting hero, Tony McCoy, all talking about the man of the day. We'll also be asking if Northern Ireland's the golfing capital of the world. Isn't it time we got the Open here? Is it ever going to happen? It's not all golf today, though, on Wendy Talks Golf. Rats in Downpatrick, we'll be chasing those, and also asking, where will the phone hacking scandal end? Your guess as good as mine on that. And you can call us, of course, with all of your views too on Talkback at 12.
Thank you, Wendy. That's Talkback coming up, as he says, at 12 o'clock. Here's a little quiz for you. Gentleman sends me a text message. Although it's not something I would normally watch, I must admit that I was glued to the television set at the weekend. The local man who starred was really great to watch. So much now that I'm going to watch everything that he does in the future. Who do you think that might be? You'll never guess it in a million years.
Darren?
No. Joe Mahon.
Joe?
Joe Mahon. So leather-tailed, spotted Ulster beside me, hedge there. Moving in because of the colour of the skin. Another mashup. This is my favorite one. Listen to this. And I bought a tooth for a tooth, both for me, and I'll set you free. Rap on, brother. Rap on. Just the greatest thing you ever heard. That's Rolling Confusion, the Rolling Stones, Street Fighting Man, with another track from them called Slave, featuring a peculiar type of drum action there, and Gimme Shelter. Also the Temptations, Ball of Confusion. I know you loved that. I know you did.
Mm-hmm.
Go on, tell me you didn't.
I did.
Of course you did. Could not. You couldn't. Anyone who doesn't like that, something wrong with them. Bit of a patriotic love.
You played it on Friday.
I know I did, but I played it again because I said I was going to play today the best mashups, and those are the best. I'm going to play some of the other ones before 12 o'clock. That was a criticism because I played it on Friday.
No.
Why should I not play it on Monday? You're just trying to catch me.
No, Friday's Friday.
Friday is Friday.
And Monday's right. Monday.
It's right. Bit of a patriotic loving going on this morning on the Nolan Show. Seems like many people are proud to be Irish all of a sudden, all because somebody won a round of golf. What's that all about? I wonder if they think the same way when Rubberneck wins the New York Marathon.
Is that you?
Ask me about my training.
I was speaking to a man last night,
mm-hmm.
and he said that if you attempt to run the New York Marathon, it will kill you.
Somebody said to me, how long is it? And I said, until I hear the ambulance.
Mm.
Well, I'm going to be careful. Don't worry. Tell that man, whoever he may be, there's no need to worry about me because I know the extent, that I know the pain, the punishment that my body can take. And I will pack up long before I reach that
point. This man
that
I was talking to last night told me that you told lies on the radio about a school play that you were in, that you played the witch. He played the witch.
He did play the witch, and I can name him.
Can you?
Yes, Willie Donaghy.
Is correct.
He played the witch, and I said another man played the witch.
All right.
I told you, the whole point of the story was that I played the girl.
I wore a
pair of knickers.
He says, you played the girl.
I wore a pair of knickers and a dress. It took me 10 years to live it down.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what are you on about then?
Well, I don't know. He just said to me last night.
Who does he think he is? Just because he's the witch, he thinks he can do anything?
Apparently, you auditioned for the witch, but you didn't get the part.
That's right. They didn't want me. They said, oh, he's a born girl, that wee fella there. Get the knickers out. Fit him up for the knickers. But the thing about that is that, you know, I've often auditioned for masculine parts, turned down.
There's a call for you.
I know, I understand. You struck a nerve there, you know.
Yeah.
It's not easy for me having to relive those days when I was always rejected. Who does he think he is? Witch. Ask your mate Harrington to give him a bucket of balls. There you are, you see. A man referring also to your prediction that Padraig Harrington would win the Open.
No, no. Let me explain. When I was talking to... When we were talking to Stephen Watson...
Yes.
And I said, there's two golfers...
And he said, good call, Sean.
I said, Harrington, or you can't rule out Big Darren.
Yeah.
That was the two people that I mentioned. And Stephen Watson says, that's right, good call. That's
I don't
what
seem
said.
To remember that.
Oh, yes, I that. Mentioned Big Darren.
All I seem to remember is you mentioning...
I said, you can't rule Big Darren out.
No such thing as a double eagle, apparently. You were right.
Darren said that on the television, on national TV, about Stephen Watson. He said Stephen Watson had more... Jokingly, he says, even Stephen Watson has dismissed him. He was...
Watson, he liked that.
Yes. But Darren knew what he was doing all right. So he said
Stephen Watson won't sleep for a fortnight.
But Stephen Watson will tell you that I did say... You can't rule out Big Darren. Even though I backed Harrington to win it. But I says, don't rule out Big Darren.
Don't squirm. You can only get an eagle at par 5.
Yes. Emma says she remembers me saying it.
Dak. An eagle at a par 4 would be a hole in one. In other words, an eagle is 3 shots below par on a par 5. No.
There's a man there to explain that to you.
Oh, no, please, no. Is a man going to talk about golf?
Apparently so.
What do you put him on for?
Emma put him on.
What's she doing? For God's sake.
She wants to know.
Hello, good morning.
Hello, Jerry.
Yes, how can I help you today? You're going to talk about golf. Make it quick.
I will make it. I can help you, Jerry, and you can help me.
All right, then.
Right. I just want to confirm what I've just heard you say on this line, that, there's no such thing as a double eagle, right?
So what is an eagle?
An eagle, a double eagle, there's no such thing.
Okay.
Right. An eagle is obviously 2 under par.
Yeah.
And an albatross is 3 under par.
Can I ask you to do something? Can I ask you to put off the radio because I can hear you twice?
Caroline, turn off the telly.
Caroline, turn off the TV. Are you listening on Sky?
Right. She's doing it now.
On Sky. That's good. A lot of people can do that, you know. A lot of people don't realise that they can. Yeah. You can hear this program in Sky all over the world.
Right, so, and you're also right in what you're saying, because I heard Sean say earlier that you can only get an albatross on a par 5. But you can get an albatross on a par 4, but as you say, it's got to be a hole-in-one.
You see, that was my theory.
So obviously you can get one, but it's a hell of a shot, isn't it?
Yeah.
And another thing, why there's no such thing as a double eagle... is because there's no one on this planet can get a hole in one on a par 5. You'd have to knock it nearly 500 yards get a hole in one.
There's a bit of practice.
A lot of practice, Jerry, and a lot of strength and skill.
Well, thank you for clearing that up. You're obviously a player yourself.
Yeah, well, I have been. I've played quite a bit.
Have you?
Now, you can help me now, Jerry, if you could.
Yes, okay.
Right. I was speaking to Sean a couple of weeks ago, and I was going to try and get back to you, but I didn't have the time, and one thing or another turned up. But it was about hats.
Yes.
Right? Now, you're an intelligent man, aren't you?
I don't know anymore.
I think you could be.
Okay.
You know? I don't care what people say about you, Jenny. I think you probably are.
Thank you.
Right? So, now I've got a selection of hats. A few which have been put stuck in a cupboard and things like that. And they've got all, like, crumpled up and things misshaped. I've got, for example, I've got a Stetson.
Yes.
And a proper American Stetson. And it, like I say, it's all misshaped.
Yeah.
So I need to take it somewhere to get it back.
Oh, to get the shape back in it.
Yeah.
Very hard, and, that, you know.
Yeah. So I'm just... there's a name for... is there a name for a person who manufactures hats or...
Hatter.
Stores them or...
A hatter. A hatter. You heard the expression, mad as a hatter. Do you know how that expression originated?
Yeah, I have, yeah.
Do you know how that expression originated?
No, I don't.
Whenever people used to make, in the 19th century, whenever people used to make kind of, you know, stovepipe hats and, you know, tall hats that people used to wear then.
Yeah,
used to, in the process of hardening the leather or whatever it is they used, I don't know what it was, they used mercury. And some of the mercury get into the system of the people who, of the hatters, and mercury in your system, or is it lead?
Honestly.
One or the other. Well, whatever gets into your system actually affects your brain. And, you know, mad as a hatter meant that the many, many hatters went insane because of that substance. It's either mercury or lead, I can't remember which. So there's the expression. Anyway, a hatter.
Really?
There are men. A milliner.
A milliner?
A milliner, I think.
And what's that, a maker of hats?
I don't know. A milliner.
Milliner.
Milliner. Is it a milliner a hat person?
Yes.
Ask Emma to look that up.
It is.
When she's funny doing her nails.
It is.
All right, yeah. Then. So it is. Yeah.
The only thing was, I mean, I was looking through the dictionary, obviously,
mm-hmm.
and trying to find it. And I was just thinking at the time, I thought, well, you know, in the right mind, if you didn't know anything about it, mm-hmm. if you was looking for a bell ringer, you wouldn't think of looking for a campanologist, would you?
No, you wouldn't.
You know?
No, you wouldn't. And I was looking at a thing the other day. Do you know what you call a man who mixes cocktails?
No.
Try and guess what it might be.
No, never. I couldn't.
No, it's obvious. I'm trying to think. A mixologist.
A mixologist, yeah.
Mixologist. Anyway, where do you live, sir?
I live just outside Bristol in England.
Oh, well, I'm sure there'd be lots of milliners about there.
Yeah.
I don't know. Milliner, check it out. Check it on the internet.
Yeah. And I'll go through the yellow pages and things and have a look.
Okay, good man.
Thanks for your help.
Listen, thank you very much for all that information. You're a gentleman.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you.
All the best, Jerry.
Bye.
Bye now.
Bye. I should have asked him why he's listening to this programme.
Apparently, the world champion mixologist works in the Merchant Hotel in Belfast.
Is that a fact?
Well,
congratulations
to
him.
Well, he did anyway. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. An albatross of 3 shots below par. It's a little golf talk here. This is my greatest nightmare.
I know.
Sean, when is Darren Clark returning home to Portrush? I would love to know. I'd love to take the kids to see him. Is it tomorrow?
I don't know, but
I think I heard someone on the news saying he's coming home today, but I don't think he's going to be in Portrush until tomorrow. But I don't know. Maybe somebody will tell me. What conditioner does Jerry use? I saw him at the weekend. I want some.
Bag into your place. We will rock you. Sing.
Well, that's another track. That's another mashup. Caught me by surprise. I don't even know what it is. Where's the thing? Where's my piece of paper? What did you do with it?
I don't know, but there's a column one, sure, in the meantime.
Hold on a second. Where is that? Where's that thing? See, I've just got so many things to do here and nobody to help me.
Well, talk to Ed. Is it Ed on one?
Ed on one? Good morning, yes. Ed.
Good morning, Jerry. It's Ed here.
How are you doing, Ed?
I'm not too bad. I believe you were talking to a friend of mine on Saturday night, Danny, referenced the mountain rescue team.
Yes, I certainly was. Oh, yes, certainly was. Tell me what the crack is. Oh, hello? It's away. It's away. What did you do there?
What did I do? I didn't do anything.
Well,
what did I do? Well, we're trying to get him.
You got him back again.
Emma said it was at her end. So we're getting it sorted out now.
A man, could you get him back again, please?
We're doing it.
Because I promised to talk to that man today about something that he's doing. Right. A gentleman from Indonesia writes to me and he said, I love your show. He lives here. Listening to your show regularly because my job is on the road driving about here in Belfast, and I really like your sense of humour. What's wrong with Sean? A couple of months ago, you played one of... I made that bit up there. A couple of months ago, you played one of Louis Armstrong's songs, which I'd never heard of before, and even I searched it on the internet or YouTube. I couldn't find it. If I'm not wrong, the title was called Lazy Summer Days. What was that called? Do you remember that?
Lazy Summer Days?
Was it called that? I don't think it was called that. Do you know what I played? I played this song because I heard Walter Love playing it. Goes, Walter plays some great stuff, you know.
Well, could you tell me a line from the song?
I can't think. Please play it again for me this week when the sun comes out. And I don't think the sun is coming out this week. And please, a man from Indonesia must be very unhappy. Did you ever see anything like the weather in this place yesterday?
Apparently it's going to get worse. It's not going to get any better.
What's wrong with... For God's sake.
A man was talking to me last night. And he said to me, he says, Jerry played a song. He says, I don't know when. And I don't know what it's called.
Don't know where, don't know when.
And I don't know the name of the singer.
Right. That narrows it down.
Could I get him some details? I said, could you give me anything? Could you give me any more details about this? He says, well, it was a guy sort of, he said he was talking. It was more or less like a monologue. And something along the lines of life gets tedious, don't it? But he says something about the fish won't bite.
That's it.
But it wasn't life gets tedious.
But what else is it?
What did you play?
Life gets tedious, don't it? But the fish don't bite, now I'm getting dandruff.
Aye.
That's it. Life gets tedious, don't it? And the reason why it sounded unfamiliar is because an unfamiliar person singing it or talking it. It's called Life Gets Tedious, don't it?
Well, I wonder who it was.
I'll soon find that out for you. And the next time I come across that particular album, which I have up in my desk sitting in a prominent place, I shall bring that down and give that another rattle.
Will you play it tomorrow morning?
I absolutely will, I promise. Will you remind me?
I shall.
God bless you.
Ed's. Ed's right. Back.
You get very excited there.
I did.
Morning, Ed.
Good morning. I actually wasn't away.
Sorry about that. Something happened in the machine here. Don't worry about it. Tell me.
All right. No,
okay.
Don't worry.
Go ahead.
No, you were speaking to Danny. He just said you would give us a bit of airspace. I'm representing the Mourne Mountain Rescue Team. We worked with yourself quite a number of years ago in the mountains in your TV days.
Was that Slemish?
No, that was in the Mournes. That was on the back of the Trassy track.
Oh, God. Right.
Where we put you in a stretcher, much to your discontent.
I'll never forget that.
Yes.
Anyway, go ahead.
Right. Basically, what it is, first of all, thanks for giving us time. As people may or may not know, the Mourne team is a voluntary team, and we need funds. And we have a very good group of people called Friends in the Mountains who are raising funds for us. And what they're doing on Saturday, 23rd, this Saturday coming, 10 o'clock to 5, they're organising a large event for us. It's the Mourne Truck and Car Show. Where we'll have vintage modern cars, trucks, all the usual bouncy castle slides, a rodeo bull, and we're having a lorry pool during it where teams of four or six people will get the chance to embarrass themselves by trying to pull a lorry 100 metres. It's a timed event. We also have a Formula One car coming. We have climbing wall, all the normal bits and pieces, and all the funds raised in this event will go to help us in our work of mountain rescue.
Okay, now, where is this and when?
It's going to be held on Saturday the 23rd of July in Donard Park in Newcastle, County Down. Oh,
very nice. I hope the weather will be a wee bit better than it was last Saturday.
Yes. If anyone wants to get further details, I can give you a number, which we're quite happy to give out. It's 028-388-1888. And that people can register on that. We're looking on the day for lorries, for cars, bikes, trucks, whatever, to take part in the event. As I say, there's plenty of other things going on to entertain the rest of the family. And as we know, Donard Park's quite a large area. There's plenty of room there. We'd be glad to see people coming down to help us out.
Okay, well, apparently the weather forecast, I had a look at it this morning because I couldn't believe that it was going to be like this all the time. Apparently next week, beginning at about Friday or Saturday, it's going to get a wee bit warmer. But I think it's not going to be, there's not going to be no sun. It'll be about like 18, 19 degrees or something like that. At least it won't be cold. I mean, I don't really mind summer as long as you're not freezing. You know, I don't really mind if there's no sun. I don't really mind if it rains a wee bit, as long as you're not freezing. Because you don't expect that. You don't expect to be freezing in July, for God's sake. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Yeah. And just to finish, a point for you, it was felt hats, and you're right, it was mercury.
It was mercury. It was felt hats. You're absolutely right. Thank you very much.
Okay, listen, thanks for your time.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Take care now. Bye now.
Bye. As a man after my own heart, a man with the information at his fingertips.
Did you notice what Ed said to you?
Ed?
No, Ed said to you the last time he talked to you was in your TV days.
I know, I heard that. I choose to gloss over that.
Yeah.
But see, my TV days are...
They're not over.
Not over yet.
Of course not.
And you also understand when he gave that number, he went 0283881888. Did you notice that?
I didn't.
Well, actually, on the news, the weather girl, she said 8 as well. It's the two-syllable 8. It's almost like Rain and 8 and Ian Paisley.
Artie's on 2.
Is he? You don't care about this.
No.
Say 8 for me.
8.
8. Why do people say 8? Two syllables. 8.
Fulham.
Rain.
Well, you Fulham. You say Fulham.
You say Fulham.
No, I do don't. Not. You say Fulham.
I say Fulham.
You do not. You say Fulham.
Fulham. Fulham. Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning, Jerry.
How are you?
I'll not ask how you are because I see you have the Monday morning hat on this morning.
What kind of a Monday hat is that?
Well, you're a great loss to the sports department of Radio Ulster, let's say.
All right, then.
No, seriously, now, we all know I'm not a great golf enthusiast myself, so we'll start from there. But as we all know, you don't have interest in the sports that you're not very good at.
No, that's correct. You've managed to crack that one.
But seriously, you had mentioned there earlier, a chap was on about a shot that was 3 under par is universally known as an albatross, which is correct.
Okay.
But stateside and in many parts of Asia, where, as you know, the game flourishes down there,
yes,
it's also known as a double eagle.
Ah, you see.
Now, it's not a great thing, and it won't make a great difference to your day, the same way that a cold pasty might. But
indeed. No, it's a cultural phenomenon, and we should be, our attention should be drawn towards it, that there is such a thing in another part of the world. Do you know the way, for instance, you know, us here in Northern Ireland, I mean, it's very difficult for us to believe that all over the world the sun is shining except here.
Exactly.
It's very difficult for us, and it's very difficult for us to understand that all over the world people are talking about double eagles, but we've never heard of it.
No, and it's just as you say that about the weather. I met a chap last Tuesday morning in the northern part of Mallorca, and the first thing he said to me was, they're getting a lovely day for the parade. That's how parochial we can be.
Well, it's the British Isles, basically. This is the wrong place to live in. And Northern Ireland particularly. I mean, everywhere in the world, the sun is shining today, except here. And this is where we choose to live. You know.
The only thing is, through the medium of Radio Ulster, you've been able to further your education, which, as you know, well started with Birks.
Oh, yes, those heady days. Those heady days.
Yes, I understand. But cigarettes were affordable, and you could get change out of a pound for a pint. Was that what you meant?
R.A. Burke & Company Shipbrokers Forwarding Agents Limited.
I was very
Londonderry and Belfast. Thank you very much, sir.
I'll say no more than
that.
And thank you for this morning, Jerry.
Thank you. Bye. Bye. There's a man who knows about my past. Did you notice that?
Well, you've talked often enough about it.
Yeah.
But I think that's the Beatles. Do you know, have you any idea who that might be? I'll tell you why I asked.
But Emma and I said, that's very good. Emma was surprised at you playing it.
No, I think it's the Beatles. I'll tell you why. Because I have a little kind of CD thing here. This one here that I hold up.
Yeah.
And there's a list of tracks on it that's supposed to be on it. So I opened up the CD thing and an entirely different CD is in it. This is because there's nobody here to help me. And I have to do everything myself. So that is, it says on that, the Beatles. That's all it says. All it says is the Beatles. That's all. That's nothing else. No other details. So I assume that that is the Beatles. I thought that was John Lennon there. But the guitar player sounded too good to be George Harrison. So I assume that that was probably Paul McCartney playing the guitar, who was a better guitar player than who was. He is a better guitar player than George Harrison was.
And also a better drummer than Ringo.
I said, somebody said to John Lennon one time, he said, is Ringo the greatest drummer in the world? He said, he's not even the greatest drummer in the Beatles.
Yeah.
I always thought that was great. Is someone on here? Listen, a gentleman's worried about you, and I can see what he's getting at. And I never noticed this until now. Let me just try and find this email. He says, hold on a second, I'll find what he says. It's about you, of course.
Obviously not complimentary when you're searching for it.
No, it's not that. Mm-hmm. No, it's just he brings up a point which I think is worthy of, well, pursuing.
Yes, of course.
It says, I'll tell you what, I can't find it, but I'll guess what it is. Here it is, I've got it. He said, his name is Ken. He said, it's very noticeable that for a golf enthusiast, Sean's response to each of the victories of our three golf champions has been very muted. What is that about? I'm just wondering. He's not accusing you of anything, but you seem strangely reticent about praising the lads. I don't know. You're not enthusiastic. You're not excited about it. That's all he's saying. You're never excited. I get more excited.
I think that's grossly unfair.
Well, it probably is.
Grossly unfair.
But all I'm saying.
I mean, I'm not even responding to it. You know, that's simple as that.
The number to ring is 0288888888. If you don't agree with that. That's all I'm saying. Mm-hmm. That doesn't dignify itself with a response.
I don't think so.
Absolutely right. Who's on the line here?
Dodon.
Dodon? I hope you don't mind me bringing that up.
Not at all.
Because, you know, warts and all, this programme. Oliver Cromwell, remember him?
Mm-hmm.
The head, Oliver Plunkett. There we go. Where is this person on the phone here?
On one.
But you do seem a little guarded today.
I'm going to tell you something now. This is absolutely true.
You're not well, are you?
No, this is true. During the game last night, watching Darren play.
Yes.
Do you see when it was over?
Uh-huh.
See when it was over and Darren raised his hands? You know what I did? I stood up in my living room and I stood in front of my TV and I applauded. On my Sweeney Todd, I just stood clapping at the TV.
And was there nobody else in the room?
Not a being. There's no one else in the house. And I just stood and I felt as though I had to do something. The only thing I could do was to stand up and applaud Darren. And I clapped in front of the TV.
Are you having a holiday this year?
There's no sign of it.
I think you should have one. I think you've reached the tipping
point. But you know, you feel as though you have to do something.
I've never felt the need to stand up at my own living room and applaud the TV.
Oh, I had to.
Okay.
That's the one, of the three boys, Darren, I would have been more behind Darren than the others.
Well, I can understand that because he's been trying for so long and it looks as if his moment had passed.
And for what he's come through and his own personal life, everything about that. And
exactly.
Leaving that aside, just for the character of the man.
Yes.
He's such a nice... I've never met him, never spoken to him.
He just comes across as a very...
If I'm hearing stories about his generosity, he's supposed to be very, very big-hearted, very kind-hearted.
Well, I'll tell you, I only met him once. I was doing this show thing in Belfast. It was the Inn Magazine Awards.
Mm-hmm.
And himself and Alison, his fiancée, came up on stage and he was very, very nice. Very, very modest and very nice. Well, I liked him a lot.
Well, can I ask you, is he a tall man?
I looked at it.
Is he a 6 footer?
I looked at somebody I saw in the paper and said he was 6 foot tall. He's not.
Is he not?
He's not, no. He's not. He didn't seem much taller than me because I was wearing my lifts.
Oh, right.
Who's this on the line here?
Don.
Where is he?
Well, I don't know. Whitehead.
Hello?
Hello. How are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
Is that DJ?
It is indeed.
Well, I must say I enjoy your show every day.
Well, thank you.
Talked to you a few years ago.
I'm glad to hear
that. Now, you were talking about a monologue there, Life Gets Tedious, don't it?
Yes.
It was recorded many, 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 many years ago by Walter Brennan.
No, there was a man before him.
Was there?
Absolutely.
I didn't know that now.
Oh, that's a very old thing.
Oh, it's very old,
That's from way in the 30s or something.
Well, I can only go back to the 40s.
No, you can go back further than that if you put your mind to it.
You're quite right. Well, I want to ask, I want to say what Jim Eastwood said about the Cookstown people.
What did he say?
I had the pleasure, well, he said the best people in the world.
Oh, well, I would agree with that.
To that effect.
Yeah.
Now, I had the pleasure of working 20 years in all in Cookstown, and I found them the most genuine and lovable people in the world.
I have to say I agree with you because I spent some time there myself.
Right. Somebody mentioned about an albatross and
yes.
a double eagle.
Yes.
I am learned to believe that a four under par is called a condor.
A condor.
C-O-N-D-O-R. It's a four out of five hole.
I was nearly expelled from university for saying something to a man about that.
I know what you said, all right.
No, no, no. Do you remember the ad for condor? Do you remember there was a guy and he'd go...
Condor.
And then... And what was the last line of that ad?
I can't remember.
A man sitting at the fire smoking a pipe with condor tobacco in it, and his last line was, "Get off my feet, boy." There was a dog at his feet.
Ah, you see, these are the things that we don't remember.
No. Well, I remember.
I remember sitting at a university lecture. Do you remember the time when the lecturers were able to smoke? There was
yes.
a man standing.
Tell him, Sean.
Desmond.
Tell him I'm about to tell a story.
He's about to tell a story, and you and I, we're not allowed to interrupt him. This is the rules, you see, Desmond. This is a kind of...
Some people don't understand.
Who says, Dawn? Oh, sorry, Dawn.
I'm still
Dawn.
Here.
Sorry, Dawn.
Tell him again. He thinks you're talking to somebody else.
So we're about to hear a story about Gerry Anderson. Do you understand, Don?
Yes, I understand. So, I'm still here.
Tommy's not allowed to talk.
You and I have to listen. We're not allowed to interrupt him. So let's listen now. Go ahead, Mr. Anderson.
It's gone off me now.
Yeah.
No, it's gone off me now. It was too hard to get. Now, this university lecturer used to stand there and I'd be in a seminar. You see, me and a couple of other people, you know, we'd be sitting there. And he used to ask us complicated questions. And he had a pipe, you see, and he would stand there like this. And he'd go, "Can any of you tell me what year the Japanese decided to build up their air force? Was it after the conquest of Manchuria or before? Could you tell me roughly what date the decision was made that the Japanese would upgrade their aircraft with a world war in view?" And anyone waited for the answer. And I went, "Condor."
Condor.
Yes?
He didn't take it well at all.
All right. Hardly expel you for that.
He threw me out of the class. He said I was a bad example to the others. Anyway, thank you for that. That wasn't much of a story, was it?
No, it was not, no.
Oh, I'm sorry. Listen, thank you very much, sir. Anything else we can do for you?
Yes, I want to tell you about a question.
Tell me about a question. Okay,
I'm
go ahead.
I'm going to ask you your listeners a question.
All right.
In the Jolson story, 1946, I and my father took the family to it. They really enjoyed it. And one of the songs was sung by Al Jolson himself. Actually appeared in it himself.
Mammy,
yep.
Yeah, walk up in the...
Ask the listeners, what was the name of the song?
I don't know.
Well, maybe somebody knows it.
Was that not the first talkie? No, it wasn't the first talkie.
No, that was a 1927
one. Okay, well, the first talkie
was... This was Jolson's story, 1946.
Yeah.
But it wasn't Jolson.
It was Larry.
See, the worst thing about this is sometimes people of a certain age, Mr. Coyle, of course, responds readily to any talk of anything before or shortly after the First World War. I, of course, me being a more modern person, don't want to talk about songs and movies in 1946, realizing that many of the listeners were not born then and aren't interested. So I just let them talk amongst themselves. There'll come a point, a natural point, when I'll be able to end the conversation. I usually calculate this to be about a minute after, or maybe a minute. I run about 10, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Very interesting.
Doing the rounds.
That's
doing the rounds. That's Larry Parks was the...
Larry Parks, he was the singer.
He mimed, but Jolson, it was Jolson singing the songs.
Yes.
But Jolson actually appeared in the film.
Right.
Singing a certain song.
I see, I've come back a little early. The weather seems to be improving, I think, a little. It's not the horizontal rain that was outside when I came in. I just was able to look out the window during the news and the, The rain has straightened a bit. It's not horizontal now, it's perpendicular, kind of like stair rods. I prefer it like that, but then you've got a chance if you've got an umbrella. If it's horizontal, it goes up your trousers.
Yes,
that's great. Johnson, look at the time it is. It's now 12 minutes. Hello? Hello?
I'm still
everything
here.
All right? Okay, God bless you all. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Right.
Anything else?
Yes. A man talked about getting change out of a pound for a pint.
Yes.
I remember a pint was only 1 and 4 pence. You get 15 of them to a pound. But nobody could afford them.
That's because you're only getting £2 a week. No, £2 a week.
Maybe not getting that.
All right, then. Thank you for that pre-war talk. God right. bless you.
Cheerio.
Bye. Why do people get over the war?
Desmond's on. It's a quiz question.
I know, but why does it go on and on and on forever? On and on. Remember Tom Raymond?
Desmond's on too.
There was a comedian. I wonder if he's still alive. No, he's probably not still alive. I remember when I was in Dublin in bands and stuff. We were up doing it.
Johnson must have appeared. It must have. Johnson must have appeared in a nightclub or something, but not as Johnson.
Sean, it's over. The Johnson thing is over.
You know what I mean? Larry Parks, because you couldn't have Johnson doing Johnson if Larry Parks is doing Johnson.
Sean, it's over.
He must have went to another nightclub in the film and a cabaret singer up singing, and it would have been probably Johnson, but not singing a Johnson song.
It's over.
That would be my answer. Did Desmond's on too?
What's it about, I'm afraid? Is it something like that again, is it?
What?
So is it something like that
a
again?
A weasel? That's about a weasel.
Oh, that's all right. I like weasels. They remind me of myself. Hello, good morning.
Good morning, Jerry.
Are you going to talk about a weasel?
Well, I would like you to try and find out how I would get rid of a weasel.
Where is it?
Well, it was in my grandson's duck house and killed his ducks.
My God. Are you sure it was a wheelcat and not a wheelcat? Are you sure it was a weasel and not a polecat or something like that?
Well, it was something anyway. It wasn't a fox anyway because a fox couldn't get in.
Just left them
lying dead with the necks with a wee hole in the side of their necks.
Oh dear. A wee hole in the side of their necks?
Yes. Where it sucked the blood out of them.
Oh God. Well, what would that be? A weasel? A stoat? A polecat?
Stoat or something like some kind of an animal like that.
Mm.
It happened down this area a few weeks ago too.
That's a job for Geordie and the shotgun.
Well, that's a job for something. I was just wondering if Geordie would know how I would get rid of it. Or
right.
Would Geordie know where I could purchase some more ducks because he's only 12 and he's in a bad way about it.
So the stoat weasel, whatever it is, obviously digs underneath, does it?
It gets in through a very small hole. It could get in through a door or anything.
Well, so there's no point in blocking it because it would get in some way.
Excuse me, does a stoat look like a weasel?
Yes, it looks like a ferret.
Yeah, they all look the same.
And what's a polecat look like?
Oh, I don't know. It's probably an American thing.
Is that what a polecat is?
A polecat's a different breed of a ferret.
Oh, it's just a ferret. Oh, I never knew that.
Yeah, polecat.
I didn't know.
Because we're always used to hearing that.
The cowboys.
A greasy polecat.
I never knew what it was.
That man's a polecat. Slippery, a slidey, untrustworthy, and slimy. That's a polecat. You polecat!
But how do you know? How do you know, Desmond? It was a.
It's one of those. It's just but because it gets into a small aperture, it gets into a small hole.
It gets in through net and wire.
Yeah, it's obviously wiry.
Gets in through
thing.
Chicken fencing.
Right.
And a weasel, a stoat or a weasel could get in through that, but a fox couldn't. Obviously.
Yeah.
It could be the witterit.
The witterit.
People in Donegal call it the witterit. That's the weasel.
I think.
The witterit.
Well, your expert is on one. Geordie.
Hello, Geordie.
Hello.
How are you? That man, you can talk to that man. Tell him what's he got in his thing, his duck house.
Hello.
Did Geordie
hear?
Hello,
Geordie. I would say it's a stoat you have.
A stoat. What would you do about that stoat, Geordie? How would you get rid of it?
Well, you can get yourself a live rat trap. Buy yourself an any hardware, a live rat trap.
What do you mean a live rat trap?
It catches them living.
You mean put a live rat in it?
No, get a live rat trap.
What's that? The dead rat trap?
That is for the stoat.
You catch the rat. The rat still lives, and then you take it away, and you can release
the
rat.
No,
what?
No, he doesn't mean that.
Are you listening?
Yes.
Go ahead.
It's a rat trap, Jerry.
Okay.
Right, a rat trap, a steel rat trap.
Yes.
Right. It's a cage, and there's like a wee door. When you open the door, open, and the drop down into it. That'll be a rat or a stoat or whatever it is.
So the same, you treat the stoat the same way as you treat a rat.
Yes, so he wants to get himself a rat trap and put a bit of old fish in it.
Yeah.
Right. And sat it.
There we go. There's your solution.
Yeah.
Good.
All right. He'll get the stoop.
Try that and let us know how you get on.
Tell me, last night, does Geordie know where I could purchase some more ducks at?
Well, where would you get a, where would a man get a few ducks?
There's a, if you get the farm week, the farm bay of farm week, there's a bay in Lisburn somewhere. And what? He has all breeds of ducks in heaven.
A boy in Lisburn somewhere.
I know, but he has only got wee ones about a week old. He doesn't sell mature ones.
Well, sure, they'll grow up in no time.
Well, you can't fight that logic, you know?
You can't fight that logic. The wee ones that can... We might have been glad to see him hunting them and all. He'd think the world of them.
Yeah, maybe you're right. Maybe you're afraid to look after them at such a young age. Whatever.
I'd prefer them a bit bigger because I would think the stoat would like them too.
I would see, we're assuming that you'll get the stoat.
Before you have the stoat caught by them.
Yeah, but see, you can't get the wee boys until you get the stoat caught.
But sure, if there are no ducks, the stoat will not come back.
Yeah, but keep the ducks there until the stoat comes.
Situation. Do you put the ducks in and then hope that you catch the stoat?
No, but have you still got some ducks left? You still got some ducks.
Have you, Desmond, have you still got ducks?
No.
They're all gone.
The five ducks
and the drake gone. So get a few of them out of the Europa Hotel. No, they're the ones they put in the bath.
You can't write to the stoat and say, do you want to visit? You know what I mean? How do you get the stoat back?
Good question. You'd need to put a couple of ducks in there.
You see?
The stoat might come back to check, see if there are any ducks there or not. Maybe he'll smell the fish. Does the stoat see in the dark, Geordie?
Oh, they would, yes. They'll take them any time.
But you could put a few stoats there, ducks there.
No, we'll get that rat trap and he'll catch the stoat and then drown the old bugger.
Put the... mercifully put down, I think, is what you're trying to say. Why don't you just get the rat trap in there anyway and see what happens if you catch a stoat? Well, it's happy days.
I think Geordie's talking about a rat cage.
Yeah, a rat cage. A rat cage, yeah.
Well, I'll get one of them.
Try that and see if you can get your stoat. If you've got your stoat, it's game over.
That's right. It's game over. Thank you very much.
Not at all. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, Geordie, and thank you for all.
Okay, now, Jerry.
God bless you. Thank you. Bye. That's good. That's called Thin Genie, and that features, of course, Boys Are Back in the Battle. Thin Lizzy, Boys Are Back in Town, and Christina Aguilera, Genie in a Bottle. You see the things you hear in this programme. Mm-hmm. Some other stuff here. No weasels in Ireland.
So apparently, believe.
Apart from Stormont and the Doyle.
Oh, no, that's...
Just thought I'd... What? It's true. Just thought I'd pick your scrambled brains this morning, and what do you consider to be the best line ever written? I have some thoughts on this. They're not to your taste. Maybe perhaps you'd be familiar with Elvis Costello's Oliver's Army or David Bowie's Ashes to Ashes. Any thoughts on the matter? That's Brendan. Best bassline ever. You can call me Al. Paul Simon. That's it.
Waldo Jeffers had reached his limit. It was now mid-August, which meant he had been separated from Marcia for more than 2 months.
Last mashup. Back tomorrow morning. Darren Clark is arriving at Royal Portrush today at midday, 12 o'clock.